Hey, welcome to In the Den with Dr. Jenn. I'm Dr. Jenn, and in this session we're going to discuss, do baby boomer women practice safer sex? An animal sexual fun fact, my favorites. And what does female erotic plasticity mean? Stay tuned. Today's Den Chat. Okay, when we think about STDs or STIs, we often think about college-age people, but what about baby boomers? Today's guest conducted a research study on this topic. Rose Hartzell is a sex therapist at San Diego Sexual Medicine who performs psychotherapy and is a sexuality researcher. Welcome, Rose.
Thanks for having me, Dr. Jenn.
My pleasure. Okay, so first of all, let's start with the foundation. Why is it important to discuss and look at safer sex and older adults?
Well, it's evident that safer sex is important in all populations. The number of STIs and HIV are steadily increasing in older adults since 2001. So that's why it's really important to talk about it with older adults.
Do older adults tend to know that? Because I feel like,
no.
Does anybody know this?
No.
I feel like this isn't well known.
No, and a lot of older women, baby boomer women in general, don't perceive themselves to be at risk. Since they've been through menopause, they might not think they need to use condoms, and they're actually 1/6 as less likely to use condoms than their younger counterpart between 20 to 29 years of age. Yes.
Okay, and who's more at risk, baby boomer men or baby boomer women? Men or women, yeah.
Women are actually at risk, at a higher risk, and that could be for a multitude of reasons. One is the physiological changes that women have as they age.
Okay.
Can make them more at risk. So, for instance, vaginal atrophy, lack of lubrication could increase the risk that they might have a tear, and then that can increase their risk of contracting an STI or HIV.
Interesting. So all the menopausal changes and the changes in estrogen in the system, what
right.
they cause. Okay.
And another thing is that they don't perceive themselves to be at risk. So we talked about that, not using condoms. And a lot of older women actually may be less likely to ask their partner to use something because they don't want to lose their partner to someone that another woman that might be less demanding.
Ah, and so, I mean, I hear that of women of all ages. Do you think it's more the case for women 50s, 60s?
Well, there is a changing gender ratio as you get older. And then in addition, there's less men
More competition,
per woman. Yeah.
So to speak.
Yeah, and a lot of baby boomer women came of their sexual age during the sexual revolution, and so they were using the pill and didn't need to necessarily HIV hadn't come about, so when HIV did come about, it was the 1980s, many were in committed relationships, and now that many are divorced or widowed, they have had no formal education about STIs.
Interesting.
Or HIV.
And do you get a sense that that folks have an inkling that it's a concern and just it's kind of too big or too difficult to take on, or do they not even know it's a concern?
I think that many people just aren't aware.
Okay.
Yeah, many older adults and baby boomers in general.
Okay. What about, because I've heard you mention before, like the physiology mm-hmm. kind of with aging and with the way HIV hits or AIDS hits, that it can be more impactful at an older age.
Right.
What's
The survival is shorter as you get older, and a lot of comorbid conditions, so for instance, diabetes, high blood pressure, all those medications that you take for those conditions can make treating the HIV more complex.
So like they kind of compete with each other in the system type of thing?
It's a little more difficult, and yeah. it can make the treatment.
Right.
And a lot of times doctors don't ask. So a lot of the symptoms of HIV will mimic those of the normal aging process. So these doctors just assume, it's this, instead of actually having them tested.
Interesting. And I've heard some folks say that in some like assisted living facilities or senior centers and places like that, that it's almost like high school all over again.
It's like a college. Yeah, it's true.
That's too funny. Mm-hmm. Okay, so what can baby boomers do to decrease the risk of contracting STIs?
Well, one thing is to ask your partner if they've been tested for STIs and HIV and actually listen to the answer. Another thing is to yourself get tested for HIV and STIs, especially after you've started dating a partner.
Yeah.
And in addition, you want to make sure that you're using condoms. So okay. You want to use them consistently and correctly.
Yeah.
Not just if you want to use them before the act starts, and don't take it off till it ends. So a lot of women actually start having sex and then put it on. So.
Right. And have you heard anything about women that have sort of just too uncomfortable when it comes to the moment of actually saying the condoms or carrying them themselves or...
Yes.
Yeah, I would think so.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I hear that with all generations, but I can imagine... you know, a generation growing up with a whole lot less public discourse around sexuality, mm-hmm. that you're not even going to know necessarily the words to use.
Well, and actually, I was doing a qualitative study before I did my dissertation study on this topic.
Yeah.
And we did interviews with women, and one of the women had actually said that she thought she would be a slut if she brought the condoms with her. And it was, she was actually less of a slut if she wasn't prepared to have sex with her partner. So.
Like it's a weird, it's kind of a, mm-hmm. a mind F U C K, which I can't say. I don't know why I didn't. They just beat me out anyway. So anyway, thank you so much, Rose, for being here. And I want to congratulate you. Rose was just about a week and a half ago got engaged to Tim, who we have in the audience here.
Yay!
She's always. If you want to find Rose online, you can visit sandiegosexualmedicine.com. The sexual fun fact. All right, I really love animal sexual fun facts. So the question is, what does the male redback spider do after it has sex with a female redback spider? A, he does a somersault into her mouth and becomes her meal. B, he does a dance to try to seduce her again. Or C, he builds a cocoon around her to protect her.
A.
What do you guys think?
A.
A. Oh, there's a loop. Anybody in the back get that too? Was there a hand up? Okay. I just want to throw. Whew, there you go. See? I know, they fly. The answer is A. He does a somersault into her mouth and becomes her post-coital meal. And so apparently this meal makes the female pause her sexual activity, which gives the male sperm a greater chance to fertilize her before another male gets the chance to come in next. Yeah. What's that word mean? Or in this case, actually, term. Female erotic plasticity. What's that term mean? Anybody? Anybody know? No? Okay.
The more you do it, your brain.
She took it to kind of neuroplasticity. No, but I like that direction. That's good. Actually, maybe connected to that. I'm not sure. Some of you may think it's like becoming really flexible or plastic in the sack. No. Not a bad guess, though. But erotic plasticity is the concept that our erotic interests can be flexible and responsive, not concrete and fixed. So this term comes from social psychologist Roy Baumeister, and he argues that the female sex drive, as compared to males, is more malleable in reaction to their context, such as to sociocultural and situational factors. This means that women's sexuality is more dependent on social norms, such as sexual permissiveness or restriction, while men are more consistent with their sexual attitudes and behaviors. So I do think there could be an aspect of neuroplasticity here. An example of this is that women's sexual orientation seems to be more fluid and flexible than men's. Perhaps this is why women tend to be more open-minded around bisexuality and gay rights. Something to think about. So, in conclusion, I want to thank you to our live audience for being here, and for Rose Hartzell for sharing her research. Yay! And you can find me online at drjensden.com and on Facebook and Twitter at drjensden. And again, touch with me if you'd like some one-on-one counseling in person or via Skype, or in need of a university speaker on sexuality and gender. Now, don't miss the funny or outrageous outtakes after the credits. And as always, be kind to yourself. We'll be right back. Yeah, can you imagine? Like, he just, it's a suicide mission. He just rolls. He goes out happy, I guess.